I'm Kelly Richdale. I'm a senior advisor at SandboxAQ and an executive fellow at the World Economic Forum.
And I'm Michele Mosca, the CEO of evolutionQ and co-founder of the Institute for Quantum Computing in Waterloo.
So, in SandboxAQ is a very proud investor in evolutionQ. Could you give a couple of words on what you do?
Yeah, and partner. So, our mission is really to create a cryptographic foundation for the digital economy that's sort of fit for purpose, fit for today's and tomorrow's economy. It's kind of like having a foundation for a three-story building, which is what we sort of had digitally in the 90s, but now we have mega skyrises and growing, and we really don't need to be afraid of the emerging threats. Some we know, some we don't know. We just prepare, and we know how to prepare. We just create cryptographic resilience.
So what do you see upcoming in terms of the both innovations around AI and quantum, some of the areas that Sandbox is active in, and then what are the threats that you see and how to overcome them?
I think the innovations will enable us to more quickly and sustainably get an inventory or a view on the cryptography use in the foundation. So we kind of know what our defenses are. We have visibility on our defenses. So when an unexpected advance, expected or unexpected advance in quantum or AI or anything else materializes, we immediately know the impact, right? There's defense in depth. So if something is broken, that's okay, because there's another layer protecting us, and we can quickly repair the broken layer. And then we just keep going forward, you know, heads up, confidently seizing the opportunities, but knowing we're well defended and able to, you know, respond to whatever the future brings.
And what do you think this year will bring in terms of new regulations coming out either of the states or Europe?
I think it'll largely, we're going to see more and more just appropriate interpretation of the existing sort of rules of the game designed to protect us, right? And seeing how quantum fits into that. And I think we're going to hopefully see more and more even people proactively deciding to create and follow the best practices that sort of naturally align with the already existing rules of the game or regulatory frameworks.
Yeah. In terms of predictions, last year was undoubtedly the year of AI, even if unofficially. This year is the UNESCO year of quantum. So what kind of technology innovations do you see upcoming this year in either of those areas?
So in quantum computing, you know, we anticipate just seeing continued progress in larger and larger scale, so-called fault-tolerant quantum computing. You know, we're at sort of at the 1 to 10 logical qubit, and we're going to see better ones and more platforms achieving it. So just a really, you know, massive expansion of that capability and our understanding of the use cases as more and more people spend time figuring out what is this good for. Because the platform is here and closer and getting more powerful, so there's more motivation to understand its usefulness. So I think that'll be one massive advance. And we're also going to see advances in protecting our digital foundations against quantum and other emerging threats through, again, better grip of our cryptographic assets and inventories and agility to respond to emerging threats. More and more deployment of the so-called post-quantum algorithms, which are the obvious sort of first line of defense. More and more real-world deployments and learnings about the alternatives, the symmetric key approaches, as well as the quantum network-based approaches. So we're going to see all three of those frontiers, you know, continue to advance in the next 12 months and create more best practices and examples for the rest of the ecosystem to sort of pile on in 26 and beyond.
Oh, any predictions around Shor's algorithm and when do we see that according to your original predictions?
Yeah, I think we've already passed the threshold where the risk of it occurring in 5 to 10 years is, you know, already beyond acceptable. So we're already in the don't panic, but go as fast as you possibly can to mitigate the known attack. In other words, Shor's algorithm on a quantum computer. We're really racing for that 5 to 10 year, your most critical assets and systems, pretty please get them done within 5 years. Like the United States government, the White House, German government, and others are saying, get this done by 2030. And, you know, the other stuff, get it done by 2035, which are really aggressive timelines. So the signal is not, oh, don't worry, you have, you know, 5 to 9 years to worry about it. What they're saying is go as fast as you possibly can, because it takes 5 to 10 years to robustly migrate your platforms without having it be a crisis management. Because crisis management is a fiasco. It's expensive and you'll get sketchy, you know, poor quality results that will make you very vulnerable to all sorts of mundane, you know, systems crash when you upgrade software too quickly without an adversary, and you're just handing a massive gift to adversaries if you're sloppy in building the foundations of your security.
I think it's excellent that the governments are taking the lead in bringing awareness of the need for improved cryptographic resilience. Mm-hmm. And this is the basic, it's the foundation of trust on which our entire system is built. But there are still criticisms that C-suite and boards are still not aware of what cryptography their system's running on, that there aren't sufficient regulations or awareness at the board and C-suite level. We're not even talking about migration to post-quantum cryptography, but simply the cryptographic inventory awareness of the need for cryptographic resilience as part of their cybersecurity posture.
I feel there's a bit of a disconnect between the leadership, who are kind of, they want resilient, appropriately risk-based resilient foundations, and the technical community, who are struggling to keep up with even more mundane attacks. And from this perspective, they might feel, oh, we've got it covered because, you know, NIST or somebody has an algorithm. But NIST doesn't do enterprise risk management for your enterprise or your sector. They give you robust building blocks you can use to properly manage your risk. So there's a bit of a disconnect. And I think we need from our leaders, business leaders, government leaders, a very clear mandate. We want appropriate levels of resilience in our cryptographic foundations, taking into account how massively systemic this is. I mean, there's concern about, you know, vendor, you know, concentration risk with vendors and so on, right? This is much more than that. This is cryptographic concentration risk, because all your vendors are using the same cryptography. So it's even more concentrated. And I don't think we've connected the dots between the real risk and the business implications. I think if we could do that rapidly and just get the high level mandate to build resilient cyber systems, cryptographically resilient, the technical teams can pull it off. Like, we know how to do it. We don't have a very clear mandate and timeline for doing it. So that we really need urgently a clear message from business leadership around the world.
Great. Thank you so much, Michele. Always lovely to see you at Davos. Yeah.